The Pangilinan-led utilities and infrastructure giant Metro Pacific Investments reports a banner year in 2023, recording its highest ever profit, lifted by a sharp rebound in its power unit and higher tariffs at Maynilad. As Jackie Pascual tells us, MPIC is allocating 140 billion pesos in capex this year.
Just a few months after Metro Pacific Investments Corporation delisted from the Philippine Stock Exchange, its chairman and president Manny Pangilinan says he is liking this new setup as a private company.
It does give us more latitude in terms of decision making and the like. No, it's just a different tone the way things are as a private company. No.
But he notes the company still acts like a publicly listed firm in many ways, even holding a media briefing and an analyst briefing, a usual staple in public companies' events. Pangilinan explains many of their businesses are those that directly affect the public, such as Meralco and Maynilad.
We still regard ourselves as a public enterprise because a number of our, almost all of our businesses are regulated and sabi nga is imbued with public interest. Those who solicit the support of the public, like media, should not be immune from public scrutiny.
After going private, MPIC was joined by San Miguel President Ramon Ang as one of its non-executive directors, which led to closer business ties between the two businessmen. MPIC through Meralco Power Gen recently partnered with San Miguel Global Power and Aboitiz Power for a $3.3 billion liquefied natural gas facility in Batangas.
You see value added, no? By teaming up with someone like RSA or somebody like the Aboitizes, no? So, and we did, I think the three of us, so be better that if we combine our resources to really, if you may, para ma-rationalize yung power industry.
Talks are also underway for the merger of the toll businesses of San Miguel and MPIC.
Putting the two tollways together, especially if San Miguel were prepared to take the Indonesian tollways into the equation, then that will be a humdinger of a Philippine company, right? Because combined, it will be the sole and biggest tollways in the country. And Indonesia will be probably one of the biggest tollways.
MPIC's reported net income rose by 90% to a record high 19.9 billion pesos in 2023, the year it delisted from the Philippine Stock Exchange. It now expects double-digit growth this year, driven mostly by its investments in the energy sector. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Just a bit more color to that story. The 90%, they nearly doubled their income for 2023. They're expecting still double-digit growth for 2024, although at a much slower pace. Out of the 140 billion peso capex they're allocating for Metro Pacific this year, that is much higher than the 80 billion they earmarked for 2022. Out of the 140, 41 billion, a big chunk, will go to Meralco. Well, 31 billion, another big chunk, is earmarked for Maynilad, 28 billion for the tollways business. Of course, MPIC's budget will be funded by a combination of loans and internally generated funds. The Metro Manila Development Council clarifies the Supreme Court's move to stop local government units in the capital region from issuing their own traffic violation tickets is not yet final. In a decision that was handed down in July last year, but only made public this week, the High Court said LGUs in the Metro must stop enforcing their own traffic ticketing system and just follow the rules set by the MMDA. The only exception will be if LGU enforcers are deputized by the agency.
Wala naman pong nakalagay dito sa decision na ito po ay immediately executory. So, may mga legal remedies naman po na available pa sa mga parties, particularly sa mga respondents. Pwedeng mag-MR, mag-file na motion for reconsideration, in which case, ito po ay hindi pa final and executory. Kung kayo po ay huhulihin ng mga local traffic enforcers, huwag po tayo makipagtalo at i-argue na sabi ng Korte Suprema ay bawal na kayong manghuli at mag-issue ng ticket. At dahil hindi pa nga po ito final and executory.
Transport operators had challenged the ticketing system of LGUs as early as 2006, insisting only the MMDA can issue violation receipts. Now, despite the controversies hounding our airports, the Philippine government is going full steam ahead in attracting foreign visitors into the country. Tourism Chief Cristina Frasco is making a pitch for travelers to, as her slogan says, love the Philippines at the ITB Berlin, that is the world's biggest international travel and trade fair. There, the Philippine delegation is showcasing the country's culture and landmarks with performances from children's choirs and try-on Filipinianas designed by designer Avel Bacudio. The government hopes this will help the country achieve its target of 7.7 million tourist arrivals this year, with Manila eventually becoming Asia's next tourism powerhouse. The push for charter change in Congress making headway. The House Committee of the Whole approved the proposal to amend some economic provisions of the 1987 Constitution. The House bid seeks to relax foreign investment limits in public utilities, education, and advertising. But aggressive, rather progressive, House lawmakers continue to voice their opposition.
If passed, Chacha will twist the principle to grossly favor foreign interests.
It is not a guarantee that it would be the sole key to economic prosperity.
Meanwhile, charter change advocates in the lower chamber are defending their move. They also deny the Education Department's claim that amending the charter will put the country's national security at risk.
May I ask if this is really an opinion of the Department of Education, or is it purely the fear of an individual who influenced the crafting of this official stand with regards to RBH7?
And the president clearly said, we have to open our country to more investments, but only, and that is why we support him, only economic amendments.
The House is planning to approve the proposed economic charter amendments before the Holy Week break on March 23rd. In other news, the Japan Credit Rating Agency maintains the Philippines' investment grade credit rating of A with a stable outlook on the back of what it described as high and sustained economic growth, supported by the government's infrastructure push and the Maharlika Investment Fund. It expects the Philippine economy to grow by 6% this year, slightly faster than last year's 5.6, but still below the government's 2024 growth target. Meanwhile, the Philippine Central Bank welcomes JCR's recognition with optimism. The country's external payments position will continue to remain manageable. An investment grade rating indicates lower credit risk or the risk of defaulting, thus allowing a country to access funding from development partners and international debt capital markets at a much lower cost. Banco Central Governor Eli Remolona sticking to his script. While more rate hikes are unlikely, it is still too early to be cutting interest rates. Remolona cited February's inflation number, which came in hotter than expected at 3.4%, with local rice prices and global oil prices posing upside risks to inflation. He also warned of second-round effects that could make it harder for the central bank to keep inflation in check.
The models and the data seem to suggest that it's still too soon to declare victory. We seem to be on our way, but there's not enough data to assure us that we will settle comfortably within our target range of between 2 to 4%. Our models say it's going to be around 3.9 for the year. So medyo it's on the edge. So I can't say that we're gonna ease soon. I think it's unlikely that we will tighten some more.
The BSP has kept its key rate unchanged at a 16-year high of 6.5%. since that off-cycle 25 basis point hike back in October to tame stubborn inflation. The Women's Business Council of the Philippines vows to assist women entrepreneurs in enhancing their businesses. This is, many believe, women, particularly those in the MSME sector, lack the resources to upscale their operations effectively. The group recently signed a deal with the Philippine government aimed at making women export ready.
The most important for women really is to scale up. Learning on, like, for example, they have a very good project concept, very good attractive product, but they don't know how it can be produced into a scaling so that they can be more efficient and effective. This is the most important learning, and that is where Women Biz comes in. Mm-hmm. We continuously doing personality development and continuously doing networking. We provide networking opportunities to all, but what I've seen with our MSME, especially women, they don't have the scaling up capacity. Yes. This is the big problem, and the market access, and to improve technology other than being digital payment, etc., but also a new way of selling online. Online selling.
You know, I think one of the, if I may say, the blessings that the WBCP had, and the DTI as well, Department of Trade and Industry, and the Philippine Council of Women, is our very, very close tie-up. We just signed another memorandum of agreement, and it's called the Regional Competitive Economic Partnership, which will then make trade to the benefits of agreements, trade agreements, reach women, and not only women in big business or small business, women, the unnamed women. Mm-hmm. So that we can encourage them, as I said, make them export ready so they can be included, they can be counted.
While wind power is an eco-friendly energy source, building the towers that capture it still generates a large carbon footprint. A Swedish company working on an alternative has just inaugurated the world's largest wooden wind turbine. It's made from laminated veneer lumber, multiple layers of thin wood assembled with adhesives. According to Modvion, wood has a better strength-to-weight ratio than the types of steel used for wind turbine towers. They're also modular, which means transporting them is simpler. Another benefit, the company says the wooden tower is carbon negative, meaning it stores more carbon than it emits during production.